Hi everyone, welcome to Bodyworks Prime. Today we're going to be going over the origin, the insertion and the action of the sartorius muscle.
Let's start by going over the location of the sartorius muscle. Here you can see the sartorius muscle in isolation. Next, let's swap to a different view where we can see the sartorius muscle amongst the other muscles of the thigh. So here we can see the sartorius from a superficial view. Let's take a look at some of the other muscles which are close by, such as the gracilis muscle, the semimembranosus muscle, the semitendinosus muscle, the vastus medialis muscle, and the rectus femoris. And lastly, here we can see the sartorius again, but from an anterior view. So next, let's take a look at the origin of the sartorius muscle, which I've marked out here in red. So we can see the red markings are on the hip, but let's try and describe which portion of the hip these red markings are on. So you can see here the iliac crest, and that's this section which I'm pointing out here. And this ridge, which is called the iliac crest, starts to move downwards. And this portion right here is called the iliac spine. So it goes from the crest, then it transitions into the iliac spine. And the iliac spine is the portion of the hip which the sartorius muscle is originating on. So specifically, that's on the superior and anterior portion of the iliac spine. So if we wanted to describe where the sartorius muscle is originating, we would say it was on the superior anterior portion of the iliac spine. So next we can see marked out here in blue, the insertion of the sartorius muscle, and specifically that's on the tibia. So let's go over how to describe the exact area of the tibia where this insertion is. So we can see right here kind of a bump or a raised area where this patella tendon is coming down and connecting onto, and this is called the tibial tuberosity. So if we go over medially, we can see that's where our insertion is. So if we were to describe where the sartorius muscle is inserting on the tibia, we could say that it's on the medial surface of the tibial tuberosity. So another thing I'd like to discuss about the sartorius muscle is its relation to something called the pes anserinus. Now what the pes anserinus is a collection of three different muscle tendons. Those three muscles are the sartorius, the gracilis, and the semitendinosus muscle. So the term pes anserinus, translated from Latin into English, means goose foot. And the reason for this is because if you were to sort of see this area on an actual human being, then the area is thought to somewhat look like a goose foot. So if you imagine what a goose foot looks like, you've got the toes and then you've got sort of webbing in between those toes. So the toes would be the bodies of the tendons themselves. And then they'd come down and connect onto the bone. And once they connect onto the bone, they'd kind of branch out and the connective tissue and everything between them would sort of spread out on that bone. And that would be kind of like the webbing in between those toes, which is what you would see if you were to kind of view that on an actual human being. So as for why you'd need to know about the pes anserinus or why it might be relevant to you, is because it does have clinical significance. So if something which is called pes anserine bursitis, and that's a cause of chronic knee pain or weakness for some people, and it occurs when the medial portion of the knee becomes inflamed. So if the bursa, which underlies these tendons of the sartorius, the gracilis, and the semitendinosus, gets irritated from overuse or perhaps an injury, then a person can develop pes anserine bursitis. So usually this happens in perhaps athletes or other people which might have an overuse sort of condition. And it's usually categorised by pain or swelling or tenderness around this particular area.
So we're back again with the skeletal model. Let's go over the actions of the sartorius muscle. So it's connecting the hip to the tibia. So it's going to have actions at two places, actions at the hip joint and actions at the knee joint. So let's go over the actions at the hip joint first. So the first action we've got is flexion of the hip. So it's pulling the tibia towards the hip, and that's what's causing flexion. Next, we've got something which is called abduction. So abduction is when the limb's moving away from the midline of the body. So you can see it's angled towards the midline at the moment. We've got this contraction and it's causing abduction. Now there's going to be a limit to how much it can abduct just because of the positioning of the origin and the insertion. So it's not going to sort of abduct past a certain position. It's not going to abduct it all the way up here. Now as well, the abduction which it is contributing to is going to be a weak level of abduction. And that's just because there's other stronger muscles which are contributing more to that movement. Additionally, we've also got lateral or external rotation, depending which one you want to call it. As you can see right here, I've moved the leg so it's in an internally rotated position at the moment. And if you imagine we've got that contraction happening, that's going to twist it outwards, which would be causing external rotation. So next, we've also got flexion of the knee. So that would be a flexed position. This would be an extended position. So flexion of the knee is also another action of the sartorius muscle. And when it's in this flexed position, it's able to pull on this medial surface of the tibia here. So if you imagine the contractions pulling it, that's going to twist the tibia medially. So we've got medial rotation as a tip of the tibia as one of the additional actions of the sartorius muscle. Now bear in mind, there's a limit to how much rotation the tibia is able to perform. And you can try that on yourself by sort of rotating your own tibia just by itself. And you'll notice it can't really rotate very much. And that's because, you know, you've got structures like all the ligaments and everything else holding it in place, connecting the tibia to the femur. And if you were to overly rotate it, you'd cause injury to all of those structures there. So if you found the video helpful or you've enjoyed it, press those buttons down there. You know which ones. Really helps out the channel. Thank you very much for watching, everyone. I'll see you all next time.